Hello and welcome to a live episode of Pop Culture on Deprogrammed. Welcome to our regular Deprogrammed listeners. You know, I am Keri Smith. I'm here with my co-host, Mystery Chris, the man behind the mask, the man behind the avatar. The cartoon that he created.
What's going on, Keri?
Nothing much. I just came off a show with Dangerous Rhetoric. We were talking about the Twitter files, which is a serious topic. And then I was like, I have to go. I'm going to go talk about bad movies. Sorry. I'm going to go.
He's like, that's what they all say.
Felt bad. But I'm very excited. We're just hanging out and having fun tonight. If you are a regular viewer and you like the show, we hope you'll hit the like button. Give some thanks to the mods in the chat. I know Pirate Tomsky is here tonight. I saw him earlier. And also, if you want to help support the show financially, we have Subscribestar, Locals, Patreon. If you can't do that, but you like the show, you can also share the links or tell people about it. So Wednesday nights, if you're new, this is a show that my friend Mystery Chris and I do about pop culture. We have different topical episodes about fathers, the portrayal of fathers in entertainment, blaxploitation films. We kind of reach back in history a bit, but tonight we're having fun and we're just talking about some of the worst movies ever made that are so bad they're actually really good that it's hard to call them a bad movie. So
yes, cult classics
mm-hmm. that are cult classics for a reason. Do you want to get started, or do you have any announcements?
Now, I have a question. This is totally unrelated to our topic, but I'm just curious. It's this to you and for the chat as well. Are you familiar with Pedro Pascal?
Yes. I've just started watching
The Last of Us,
yeah, the okay. HBO adaptation of the video game. And as a zombie movie and zombie book and zombie comic book fan, I really love it. And then when I realized who he was, I was like, I wish I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Okay, why? What about him?
All right. Do you think he's attractive?
All I've ever seen him in is this new show, The Last of Us. Yes, because mm-hmm. he's like covered in dirt and he looks very.
So you two, this is a woman thing, because I asked because I was around coworkers today, two female coworkers, young, in their 20s. And they're talking about how hot he was. And I was like, really? Like, I ain't into dudes, but if I was, I'd have better taste than that. I mean,
well, I've never seen him in anything else. I've just heard about I've seen what a jerk he is on Twitter. Like, what a moron. Let me look at him when he's not covered in dirt.
Yeah. I think he was on, what's that show, Narcos or something? That's what people were, I think. I never watched
it. Yeah, I never watched that.
But it just reminds me of like Benicio del Toro, because I remember female friends would rave about how hot Benicio del Toro was. And I was like, really? Like, I don't understand women.
Look, let me look at Benicio. Oh, yeah. Benicio del Toro. Yeah.
You saying yes, he is hot?
Yes.
I don't even know who you are, Keri.
Sorry. look, it's more about the, what's the right word? The not ambiance. That's
the aura.
The way
he carries himself.
Here's a great example. Have you ever seen Harold and Kumar Go to White Castle?
Yes.
Okay, so there's a scene at the end where you're watching the whole movie, and I wouldn't say that I was like that. I found John Cho or Cal Penn attractive until the last scene. When John Cho is in the elevator with the girl and he's wearing that white t-shirt and it's all dirty and he's all sweaty, his hair is all messed up. And then it was like, dude, that guy's attractive. It's
you
more
just like dirty dudes.
If you look like you could fix a plumbing leak. Yes. Or take out a bad guy.
So I wonder if there's women out there that love sanitation workers. I guess sanitation workers are so hot.
Don't you remember the commercials in the 90s, Diet Coke break? That's what we're talking about here. The, yes, this is a thing. Go back and look at those commercials. It's where the women are all in an office and they're like, Diet Coke break, Diet Coke break. This is from the early 90s, I think. And they run to the window and they all get the, and they watch this construction worker across the street. I guess they, you're supposed to get the idea they do this every day at lunch. And they watch this dirty, sweaty construction worker open a Diet Coke and drink it. And they're all like,
wow. Learning all sorts of things tonight.
Pyrotonsky says, confirmed, women love working men. Yes. Anyway. Why were you asking about that about Pedro Pascal?
Because I heard my coworkers talking about how hot he was. I was like, what? This is a thing?
Look at Adam. Adam says, I shoveled my driveway four times today. No dice. Look, you should walk around before you take a shower and get all nice looking. Walk around like after having done that physical activity and see what happens in your neighborhood.
Yeah, I'm going to go roll around in some dirt. Walk to a restaurant. Hey, ladies. No, I'm not homeless. Why would you ask such a thing?
Not homeless. That's not what I'm attracted to. Just someone who looks like they can get their hands dirty fixing something. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. So, moving on. Oh, I do have an announcement to make. April 15th, if you're in the Austin, Texas area, or if you want to travel here for it, Minds.com, which is an alternative online platform, they are having another one of their conferences. The last one they had was at the Hammerstein Ballroom last year in New York, and there were a ton of people there. This one's going to be in Austin, Texas at the Vulcan Theater. And it's going to, so far I know Tim Pool from Timcast is going to be there. Ian Crossland, Jack Posobiec, Destiny. There's going to be music and comedy. Jamie Kilstein, his comedian, is going to be there. And I'm going to be hosting. And so you can find information at minds.com. You can get tickets. And if somebody has the ticket link, please drop it in the chat for me if you know where it's at, or I'll go find it in a second. Hey, what's up, Amy? Two sisters and some yarn. Okay, that's my only announcement. Let's get started. Bad movies. What's your favorite?
Let's do it. All right, we're starting way off the bat. All right. My favorite is Miami Connection. And for those who don't know, Miami Connection was a movie, an 80s movie, created by a South Korean guy who was a Taekwondo instructor, and he loved Taekwondo so much he wanted to promote it that he took out his entire life savings to make this movie. And the story of the movie involves a band, a college band, that sings songs about Taekwondo and that gets mixed up with some cocaine trafficking ninjas.
You showed me this movie.
Yes.
Yes, I remembered as we were compiling our list, I'm like, oh, in Miami Connection. Then I remembered, oh, Mr. Chris actually introduced me to this.
Yes. And this movie, go ahead and play a trailer. And we'll
okay, we're going to enjoy the trailer to Mr. Chris's favorite bad movie.
Gentlemen, we have a special treat for you today. We have a new house band with a new dimension in rock and roll. We have the one, the only, Dragon Sound!
I love this music so much.
This band is the only family I have.
They're all black belts in Taekwondo and they're pretty bad.
I want you to mess it up by going out with a secondary musician like that John character.
They came in here to play goddamn songs for kids!
Thank you.
Much kicking. I love it.
Boss, everybody's done.
The longest trailer.
So the guy, the Oaks looking guy, he wrote the music. So there's two songs that the band sings, Ginston and Jen Friends for Eternity, Forever was it. But yeah, he wrote the songs. Yeah, I think he was married to the singer in this movie for a while in real life. But this movie, the South Korean guy who made the movie tried to shop it around to distributors. No one bought it. No one at all. Everyone thought it was horrible. And so it ended up showing like in a few theaters for like a night or something. And I found a review from one of them we can pull up in a moment. But it sat, you know, on a shelf somewhere for years. And then in 2012, the Alamo Drafthouse found a copy of it because they had a series where they just find weird, funny movies.
Yes.
And they ended up contacting him and buying the rights to it. And ever since then, it's been introduced to the public. It's become a big movie amongst circles that are into really bad movies. They actually did a reunion of the actors who are in this movie, and I have a clip to I put in there of them at the Alamo Draft House 10 years ago.
Is it the one called Clip?
Let's see, which one is it? It's the reunion one. There's two reunions.
Okay, yeah. I see it. Hold on, let me pull it up. Alamo Draft House has been single-handedly responsible for breathing new life into a lot of these really terrible movies, and like you said, finding the best. The best ones, the ones that actually have merit because they're so bad that they're entertaining. Not bad, boring, but bad, good, you know?
It was the one in Austin that did that. I don't know if the other ones do. And in fact, I don't know if the Austin one
And the one in Austin one is closed down. Did you know that?
Well, the one that's in downtown is closed, yeah. But the other ones are open. But the one downtown was the one that played, like, the weird movies.
Yeah. Pirate Tomsky for £10. Thank you, Pirate Tomsky. He says, one of my favorite bad movies is Battlefield Earth. It's so shit that it's actually good. Haha. This was before I knew it was a Scientology movie. I didn't know it was a Scientology movie. What? What? I had no idea. Thank you, sir. Okay. We've got this pulled up. This is the reunion.
Yeah. You don't have to play the whole thing, just a little bit of it.
All right, good evening. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like to welcome you to my
co-creator of Alamo Draft House, too.
Central Texas's hottest nightclub. Tonight, we have a special treat for you. We have a new house band with a new dimension in rock and roll. We have the one, the only, Dragon Sound!
They actually found all the actors.
Against the ninja, we will fight the battle to win.
It's so funny because these songs and these kind of really bad movies, if they have songs, people get into them.
Yeah, it's a catchy song. It's cheesy, but it's catchy.
But it's catchy. It's like Hard Ticket to Hawaii, which we're going to talk about in a little bit. I've had that song in my head for 2 days now. Like, I'm just like, I wake up in the morning like, Hard Ticket to Hawaii.
It needs to be a compilation CD of this, songs from bad movies.
Yes.
And I like, just like in the movie, the guy, YK Kim, the South Korean guy there, he's not playing the guitar at all, nor was he in the movie.
Wait, what? He's not playing it?
No, no. In the movie, too, he's doing the same thing. It's not plugged in. He's just doing random things on the guitar.
He's just faking it?
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. I have to show this to my husband. Let me see. They're like, they're miming it.
Yeah, I mean, most of them aren't even musicians. Actual artists, musicians, but the John Oates guy is.
Oh my God! So this track is probably just being played over the loudspeakers, and they're just
yes.
The band's not playing anything.
No, I think this guitar is John Oates guy is. You can hear him, but everyone else, no. And she's singing, obviously.
Oh, that's hilarious. Oh my gosh. Okay. Do you want to play more of this?
Oh, that's it.
That's the best.
There is, let's see, what was the other one I said? There was one more clip from the reunion. I just want to show a little bit how they, or no, never mind. Scratch that one. Play the the clip.
Okay.
Miami Connection clip. This is probably my favorite moment of the film. This is one that should have won an Oscar, but Hollywood doesn't value excellent movies. They're not financed by Harvey Weinstein. If you go to the minute mark.
Okay.
Or, actually, go back to 40 seconds. Sorry. Sorry about that. I got this right.
I thought we are all orphans.
Orphans?
Yes. He just got a letter from his strange father.
And my father was Black American. She gave me this picture when she was real sick. I was only 9 years old. And we never saw him again. She told me to find him. I didn't like him because he left us.
But... My father! I found my father! Oh my God!
Yes, that scene goes on for so long. It's so hilarious.
Okay, what is it? What is it that makes a bad movie so bad it's good?
Here's my theory. I think the best bad movies, like the most popular ones made in the last 30 years, 35 years, or let's say 40 years, are movies made by foreigners who were inspired by American cinema, but didn't understand it or how to make a movie. So you have Miami Connection, South Korean guy, Italian director, Samurai Cop was Iranian director, The Room, Tommy Wiseau is Polish, and then
Troll 2, they were Italian,
yes, right? Italian, yeah. Birdemic is a Vietnamese man. So you have, again, foreign directors inspired by American cinema, but just they don't get it, they don't know how to make a movie. And so it's like this weird mix, like, because I'm sure they grew up watching movies in their own country, and a lot of times those movies don't necessarily translate as well to, you know, English, especially older ones. Newer ones are more, I think, globalism. There's more similarities between foreign movies and domestic movies now, but back then it wasn't. So yeah, it just, I think it's that, and I also think one of the telltale signs for bad movies is completely pointless scenes.
Yes.
Like, that's the difference between, say, Sharknado and the Sci-Fi Channel type movies. Because those movies try to be bad. They're too self-aware, which it is possible to make a self-aware kind of campy ones. Because Hard to Go to Hawaii, the Andy Sedaris movies, they're campy, they're tongue-in-cheek, but he manages to pull it off of those. But it's harder to do. And so a lot of times when you have pointless scenes that go on, when you have actors that are clearly not talking to anybody, where the scenes are filmed as individual shots and nobody's reading lines back to them, they're just reading off lines, you can tell that, you know, there is no direction practically involved. I think those little things that what makes these movies so good, because again, like when Sci-Fi Channel, other, you know, groups try to make bad movies on purpose, a lot of times they still have some skill involved, but it's like if you go to an artist, a really good artist, and tell them to like draw a horrible picture, like the whole time they're going to fight this urge to correct the mistakes, because as a good artist, that's what you're constantly trying to do. And so I think a lot of people with movie experience are still, even though they're in the head saying, oh, we got to make this bad movie, they can't help but still make things a little bit better than what they would or because should be if trying. It wasn't authentically bad.
Yes. Because they're trying, yes. But okay, I get what you're saying there. Like an authentically bad movie where someone's not trying, they're not, it's not tongue in cheek, it's not satirical, they're not trying to make a cheeky good bad movie. They're trying to make a good movie and they don't succeed. Like it's a bad movie. But what separates it? What makes it so bad that it's good? Like is it because there's a ton of bad movies. I think I mentioned to you in one of our previous episodes, I saw the Firestarter remake. It's terrible. It's terrible, but it's not, there's nothing about it that's so bad it's good. And so I was thinking about these, and I think you're right. I think it's still likable. It still makes you laugh. The acting is so bad. The acting has to be so bad. It can't be good actors with a bad script. It has to be bad script, bad actors, bad costume design, bad music, all of it bad. Yes. Like, I almost feel like all of that.
Failure on all levels.
On all levels. And that's where it will rise to where it's like, oh, like, this is no. Like the Firestarter remake, I can't remember who was in that. It was a well-known actor. I mean, it has good actors. The actors weren't bad. You know, the script was terrible. Some of the production value was terrible, but it wasn't bad on across every level. And that's sort of just like, oh, not worth watching. But if they right. really hit the trifecta of like everything's bad.
And I think also think like a lot of these so bad they're good movies, a lot of times the makers are still they're incorporating tropes into the movies, and it almost becomes like a satire, even though they're not intentionally making fun of it. And it becomes clear that, you know, they're trying to make a movie. It's just, it's when you see so many of these tropes so many times, seeing it in a really bad movie, you kind of laugh at it because, again, it's almost functions like satire in a sense that it's kind of showing how silly sometimes these premises can be.
Yeah. Well, there's a couple of people who've weighed in chat. Let's see. Blarb says the key is sincerity. Yeah. That's not what you were getting to, Mystery Chris. They're being sincere and trying to make something. Flash Gordon. Oh my goodness.
That's a campy movie. I love Flash Gordon. And I don't think it's like a funny movie. It's campy.
It's campy.
But I like it. I enjoy it.
It's great. Warriors, I would put in that category too. Would you? Campy. I love it.
Warriors.
Yeah.
The Baseball Furies.
Yeah, I don't know if I would put those in bad movies.
Yeah, I think Warriors is a good movie. There's silly parts of it, but it's still a pretty good movie. Because there's another category of movies that aren't like great movies, but are still enjoyable, like Dr. Giggles, mm-hmm. Maniac Cop 2, which I love.
Big Trouble in Little China. Come on, that's just a good
movie.
That's the only good movie.
That's great.
That's just a great movie. That's yeah. There's nothing bad about that. I'll fight you naked.
They were supposed to be remaking that film. I remember The Rock was attached to it. I don't know what happened to it.
No.
No.
I don't want them to remake that.
So you okay, said well, Buckaroo and Banzai yet? I love Buckaroo and Banzai, but
nobody's.
It's a weird
nobody's
movie.
Nobody's mentioned that one yet. Yeah. Well, so your favorite is Miami Connection.
Yes,
my favorite would have to be Troll 2. And it was like, I don't know, 20 years ago or something that I first saw this movie, and I loved it so much that at the time, this will also date myself, people still had VHS. I mean, we had DVD players, but we also had VHS. We would have both. This is when you would still have both. And I went on eBay and bought like 20 copies of the original VHS of Troll 2, and I would just wrap it and give it as Christmas gifts to people because it was such a great bad movie and I wanted them to see it. And little did I know, lots of people were doing this. Troll 2 became a cult classic. It was so bad, it was good. There were tons of, at one time it was legitimately the worst ranked film on IMDb. That's where it really, people started to pay attention to it because they think it had the lowest rating of all time on IMDb. But then as the people started this grassroots word of mouth, like what I was doing, where people were like telling people about it and everything, bringing people to then there started being these midnight screenings. I remember going to a midnight screening of it in Los Angeles, where I was living at the time. And the line was wrapped around the block. And then it started to get this cult popularity. And so then the IMDb rating started getting higher. People were going there and giving it 10 stars. Like, it's the best, or five, whatever the top is. But so this is what I'm talking about. Troll 2 is bad on every level possible, in every possible way, from the script to the premise, the script, the casting, the acting, the music, the costumes, and even the marketing. So check out this box. The reason I was buying, I've got this up on the screen. The reason I was buying the VHS copies is because the VHS copies had the original cover. Now, a couple things about Troll 2. These were Italians who made a movie in the US about goblins. If you haven't seen this movie, nary a troll in the movie. There's no trolls, and it's not even about trolls.
Yes.
About goblins. However, when this movie started to come out, there had just been a movie that had hit in the US that was pretty popular at the time, I guess. Troll, the first Troll with Julia Louis-Dreyfus. There was a movie called Troll, US movie called Troll. And so the Italians would often do this. They did this with Zombie 2 also. They would name things 2. They would put a 2 on it. So try to trick Americans or people abroad into thinking this was a sequel to something that had just come out. And so they called it Troll 2. Even though there's no trolls in it, it's all goblins. But they were like, hey, you know, maybe people will rent this because they'll think it's a sequel to the Julia Louis-Dreyfus movie. The other thing that's great about the original cover is, for some reason, they picked this picture of, there's a little boy here on the stairs. That boy's not in the movie. Who's that boy? He's not in the movie. That little kid's nowhere in the movie. Look, there's a big old werewolf behind him with an axe. What? Is there a werewolf in the movie? No.
And like you said, like we were talking about, like, legitimately bad movies. A lot of times they introduce characters either through the marketing or in the movie and are never seen again, or just replaced by another person. It's just not explained.
Yes. Two sisters and two yards is, geez, spoilers. Hey, if you're being spoiled on Troll 2 at this point, it's not my... This is so silly. Yeah, there's no werewolf. And then the tagline up here says, the original boogeyman is back. What? Who? What boogeyman are you talking about? Everything about this cover, this marketing choice, is bait and switch. It's like, that alone, I was like, this is epic. Who did this? Oh my goodness. Look at Wikipedia snippets. So they were trolling, were they? Aha. I see what you did there. Anyway. That alone makes this, in my opinion, just the cover of the VHS. And they eventually changed it once it started to get popular. Now they've got one of, here you can see on the side of the VHS there, they've got a picture of one of the goblins, and they eventually put one of the goblins on the cover, which I don't like. They should just keep this original cover because it makes it even better. So we'll take that down. So what should I do? Should I show the trailer for anyone who hasn't seen it?
Do it.
Okay. Here we go.
Yeah, I remember seeing this movie when I was a kid. And the ending, like, creeped me. Should I be concerned with spoilers?
No! Don't be concerned with spoilers. This movie came out in 1990.
The little boy comes downstairs and sees his mom being eaten by the trolls / goblins.
Goblins.
And it was clearly like a mannequin. Like, it's just a torso of a mannequin that they covered in green slime. I don't know why it's green slime. Maybe blood was too violent or expensive, like red liquid. I don't know. But I remember just being, like, really, like, upset. Not the fact that they killed his mom, but that they were eating his mom. I was like, that was so disrespectful. Like, it really bothered me how disrespectful that was.
Yeah. Just grotesque, you mean? Gruesome?
Not even the gruesome. It's just, it's disrespectful to eat someone's mom, Keri.
Are you serious? Are you joking with me? Are you being serious? You were offended?
Yes.
Not by the bad quality of the movie, just like there was cannibalism of a mother.
Yes. Disrespectful.
Or goblins eating. Okay, here's the trailer for Troll 2. If for some reason you haven't seen this movie by now, I feel like everyone's seen it, but if you haven't, and if you or if someone in your family really loves bad movies that are so bad they're good, this is my favorite.
You're late.
I'm sorry we had a small mishap.
Here are the keys. Here are ours.
Do you see this acting? Here are the keys. Here are ours. like you said, unnecessary dialogue and script. They just hired people in this small town to be in the movie. So people in the movie just lived in the town where they were shooting. Like the guy who plays the dad, he was a dentist who just lived there. Okay.
Have a nice stay in Milpon.
You in our city.
You're telling the same story, Josh.
Powers of evil are very strong. I must leave.
It's the most terrifying part.
Goblins don't exist. Goblins don't exist.
And remember.
They're eating her.
They're eating.
Say the famous line. Say it.
So dizzy.
Love ice cream.
Delicious and purified.
Overacting 101.
Okay, somebody in the chat says, is that Billy Ray Cyrus? And oh, it was Two Sisters and Some Yarn. And your average patriot nerd says, do yourself a favor and watch this. Raphael says, I can't waste my time with bad movie. Raphael, you missed the point. We're not highlighting bad movies. Bad movies are a waste of time, like the remake of Firestarter. We're highlighting movies that are so bad, they actually become good. Somehow there's this transformative thing that happens and they get elevated. This is a good movie to watch.
and a lot of these movies we're talking about and are going to talk about are on YouTube or archive.org. like, I know The Room is on archive.org. there's some other movies and we're going to talk about that are on YouTube, so might give it a little look.
Yeah, you talked about weird unnecessary scenes. I'm going to show a clip from Troll 2. You're right. See, they didn't know. That was the original trailer. They didn't know how bad it was, I guess. And they tried to cut something together that made it look exciting. So it actually doesn't include very many of the very, very funny parts in that trailer. They probably wouldn't have put those in because they're some of the worst bits of dialogue. But they've become the most quotable bits. Like you were saying, say the line. Say yes. Oh, my God. I knew exactly what line you're talking about. Let's see. Yep. Here is a scene that just doesn't make... There's a lot of scenes that just don't make any sense. And I wonder if you know which scene I'm going to bring up. Okay.
I don't think I do.
It's the corn scene. Okay, but we're going to skip ahead. So he's hiding out in this trailer, and this bad guy, this who is a goblin but who looks like a sexy woman, is trying to get him to eat this corn. It's a long story. It doesn't make any sense, but basically these goblins, they try to get humans to eat this stuff that they put in the food that will turn the humans into plants, so then they can eat them, because they need to eat the goblins need to feed on things that are like half human, half plant or something. It's ridiculous.
Logical. Anyway,
logical.
Shall we eat
it together? Program. I'm real. Come out. Can you see? I think they were like, let's make a sexy scene. Okay.
Yeah.
And what should we have her trying to offer him? Corn.
So this could easily be a porno.
I thought there was a hot babe out here.
I'm just coming out for the corn. You like this corn?
The hottest thing he's ever seen.
The music too.
Of course.
She puts the corn in her belt. She stashed this corn for later.
Do you like it?
Scenes just go on too.
I know, it goes on
too long. Do you know what I mean? Yes. Again, like everything from start to finish, the acting, the script, the unnecessary, like the directing. Like, yeah, let's just lengthen this scene. Pirate Chomsky says, "You can keep your corn on." Awkward. Okay. Wouldn't you be like, lady?
What's the matter? Aren't you hungry?
She made up some corn and cob.
Actually, I like popcorn.
Well, no problem. All we have to do is
heat it up. Yeah, the pacing on this is terrible, right? It's absolutely terrible. And so is the lighting. Yes, every bit of this is terrible. Look at this.
It's turned into a commercial with popcorn.
Isn't that insane? And then he gets covered in popcorn. Anyway, that's just an absurd, random, if you haven't seen it, Kevin, trust me, the pacing, all of it is awful, but awfully good. And you'll be watching it like, what is this? Laughing. You should watch it with friends. It's like, I'm just, yes. The LPJ, what is this? This is Troll 2.
This is art, my friend.
It's my favorite bad movie in terms of like most entertaining bad movie. It's just from start to finish, it's terrible. There's a lot of other weird quotable lines. Like there's the part where they go into the general store. Do you remember that part? And he's trying to get something to drink, and he asks for some milk, I just remember this line for some reason. Hold on. This is just a quick line. If you saw this guy coming in, I'd be like, ah.
There's no coffee here in Nilbog. It's the devil's drink.
Coffee's
the eggs.
Are you crazy, boy? We're vegetarians here in Nilbog. Didn't you know that?
I just love that. Eggs. There's no coffee in Nilbog. It's the devil's drink. So stupid. Anyway, the whole movie is that terrible.
You saw the movie, the documentary, of course. Best worst movie.
Okay, yes. So I guess we should be leading up to that. So yeah. Much like Miami Connection, where it became such a phenomenon that there was this reunion, this became so big that some of the actors who were in Troll 2, including the guy who played the little boy, the dentist who played the dad, they started coming out, and the director, I think, they started coming out to screenings like the one in LA, and they were doing Q&As after the screenings, and it became such a phenomenon that there was a documentary produced called like Best Worst Movie in the World. Something to that effect. I'll pull up something about it in a second. But speaking of the actors, I did see a super chat go by that I would be remiss if I didn't read now, because Binary Bard for $5, thank you, says they filmed Troll 2 in Heber City, Utah. A friend and former co-worker's mom was in the movie. Nice. What? No way. I wonder
find a copy of the VHS tape.
Yeah, I wonder who she played. If you're still in the chat, tell us who she played. Was she like an extra, or did she have a role that we would know? Okay, should we play a little bit of the Troll 2 screening?
Yes. Is this the one where the director is there? Or is this one of the other screenings they were showing the movie?
Yeah, I can find one of those if you want. Let's see.
Yeah, they had the director show up. He was not expecting the audience reaction.
I don't know if that's the one that I have. Hold on.
Well, if you can't find it, it's all right, but
hold on. I am gonna pull this up with the director.
Yeah, but in this documentary, it's the main guy, I forget his name, but the guy who's the dentist in real life, who
George something.
Yeah, decides to find all the actors that were in this film and catch up with them and see what they're doing and how this movie's affected them, for better or for worse.
And there's some crazy stories about them too. Like the woman who played the mom ended up going crazy.
Yeah, she turned a cat lady.
So yeah. Sad. Okay, so this is the director of Troll 2. After it became this phenomenon, there's like, you know, North American tours of the film and the actors and this documentary being made, and so now the director comes out to talk about the deeper meaning of the movie.
Due è un film che su cose molto gravi, molto importanti, come mangiare.
Did you see that? I'll translate for anybody who's just listening and not watching. He says, Troll 2 is a film that examines many serious and important issues. Okay, and then he says, like eating and living and dying.
Brilliant.
Morire. È un film importante, dice.
It's an important film.
Parla della famiglia.
Which talks about the family and the union of the family.
The destruction by trolls.
Del senso di una famiglia.
resisting all of those things that want to destroy it and see it dead.
Piglia contro tutti quelli che la vogliono vedere morta. People want to eat this family. People want to eat this.
It's relatable. People want to eat this family.
They're very tasty.
The universal story.
In Italia diciamo una parabola.
In Italy we call this a parable. Okay, I just thought that was really funny because
the great thing about that director is he takes it seriously. Like, there's a clip from the documentary where he shows up to one of the screenings, and you know, he's expecting people to be like marvel at the movie and clap, but everyone's laughing. He gets angry and walks out. Like, he's like, I can't believe all these people are laughing at this film. And I was thinking, like, for all of these bad movies, like, these creators put their hearts, their lives in it. Especially like we were talking about Miami Connection, where the guy took his entire life savings and put in that movie. And for them to like go to these, you know, movie watches where everyone's laughing at it, like, yeah, they have to be like smiling on the outside, but inside they have to be like crying. So they're laughing at their passion project.
I don't think they have to be crying on the inside. I think it's a sign of someone who has all hubris and no humility that director couldn't just laugh with everyone and be grateful for the fact that his film is so bad that it's wonderful. Like, don't pretend that it's a good movie. You know, have some humility. It's a terrible movie. Yes. We've all done things that we know didn't turn out the way we may have had the best intentions, but we know they didn't turn out the way we wanted. We didn't do our best work for whatever reason. I think if you're a reasonable, honest person, you should be able to admit those failures and be humble about it. And don't pretend that you're better than you are, or that the product is better than it. Don't pretend. That's to me, him sitting there talking about how serious this movie is, like, dude, you're so full of yourself. I don't care that you speak like this. You're full of yourself. Like, the movie's terrible, but be honest about that and be grateful and be humble that, like, I made such a terrible movie. It became the best, worst movie of all time. God is great. Like, that, you know, that would have been, you don't storm out because people are laughing at your shit movie. You say, you laugh with them and embrace them that they love your piece of crap movie.
I mean, they should, but the thing is, when I listen to interviews, like, when I listen to an interview with the guy who made Birdemic, like, he legitimately thought he was going to get, like, a motion picture deals from big movie studios, and he's still, like, hoping that they'll, like, pick up Birdemic and make some Hollywood-quality ones, even though he's still making low-budget Birdemic stuff, but, like, there's, like, this weird disconnect where they don't fully understand how bad the films are.
There's something off there, yeah, with both of them. And they both also kind of ripped off things. I mean, we talked about the marketing, how they ripped off. They tried to present themselves as a sequel to Troll 1, which they had, the movie had nothing to do with Trolls. But the other thing they did is they had scenes, like, in the beginning with the little boys in the bed and the grandfather's reading him a story, and they were blatantly ripping off The Princess Bride, like, the beginning, the setup of The Princess Bride. And Birdemic or whatever, it was blatantly ripping off the birds. I mean, okay, I am gonna show you the trailer to Pyrotomsky says, are we gonna get to a vote on the best worst movies? Yes, actually, we should do a poll. I'm gonna create a poll while we're watching stuff from Mystery Chris's next pick. But before we do that, just quickly, here is the trailer for the documentary that was produced. Best worst movie.
Are we going to do two fillings today? I think we are, aren't we?
By the way, this guy, the dentist who played the dad in this movie, totally lovable guy. That's what I'm talking about. Completely humble, completely grateful. That's what I'm talking about. That attitude is just beautiful.
Yeah, he seems like a nice guy. And he has an arc in this documentary too, which is interesting.
We don't speak too much about it.
Is that really my son?
It was so not him.
The strangest thing to watch.
Will you kill me if I tell him?
No, tell him.
It was just crazy because nobody in the community even knew that George was in a film.
I was in a movie back in 1989. It's called Troll 2, and it's become known as the worst movie of all time. Yes.
Well, I laughed in about the middle of the movie.
So bad.
I maybe hoped it wouldn't be as bad as it was, but it was.
I had no idea what it all meant or what I was doing or what I was saying.
By every conceivable measure, this is a bad film.
Oh my gosh, that's the worst movie I've ever seen.
There's this movie you've got to see. I've watched it a million times.
Thank you all for coming to the 5th annual Los Angeles Troll 2 party.
Oh my God, you didn't see it?
You haven't seen Troll 2? We're watching it now.
That's what people do with this movie. They pass the DVD around like it's Bible.
2 decades after it was made, Troll 2 is finally finding an audience.
Oh, I should tell you, I forgot about this, Mystery Chris. There was a brief time during this ascent in popularity before the documentary came out, I considered and was trying to get tickets to go to this Troll 2 big like convention party.
Oh, I should have gone.
That was going to be in Utah. If anybody in the chat went to that, let us know.
It is sold out for tonight.
My friends and I thought we were like the only people in the world who knew about this.
Wow. Hey, that's an issue.
I don't feel that kind of feeling when I'm drilling the cavity.
Oh, 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 it's my only option. What do you think you were to the worst movie? I did a very good movie.
Hey, look at that director still sitting there. I did a very good movie. It's very good.
Action.
You are an actor. Okay. You cannot laugh.
I really wanted to be an actor from the start.
Oh, boy.
I think George was born an actor. Dentistry is just a stage.
Can I ask you another question?
Honestly, I'm like a cult luminary. When I go to these screenings, I would never dream. Does anybody want my autograph?
But anyway, we'll go over your treatment plan in just a second. So.
I was in a film. I was in a film called Troll 2.
Okay. That's so great.
That's awesome.
Okay, so that was my favorite. That's my favorite worst movie. If you're just joining us and people are asking what are we doing, we're just having a fun night and talking about movies that are so bad they're good. We're not talking about bad movies, simply bad movies, not worth watching, but movies that are bad in every conceivable way possible from beginning to end, from the conception to the script to the casting, the directing, the acting, and even the marketing, the lighting, and the costumes. So when they are elevated somehow to the status of very entertaining, how does that happen? Okay, so what's your next one?
My next one is a 1985 movie called Rappin'. If you could bring that trailer up. So this was a movie that was produced in the 80s to kind of get in on the rap craze. In our episode where we talked about the commercialization of hip hop, you know, I mentioned how the 80s, particularly like kind of mid to late 80s, was this weird time where a lot of corporations understood that rap was becoming popular with, you know, non-urban audiences, and they wanted to cash in on it, but they didn't quite understand it or how to market it. So this movie, which is an unofficial sequel to the Breakin' movies, which is basically the same plot as Breakin' 2 Electric Boogaloo, which is the greatest movie title in history. And can't find a better one than that. But it's basically the same plot. Some group of inner city teens, or there, a lot of them are like in their 20s or 30s, but they're playing teens. There's a real estate developer that's trying to develop some inner city Pittsburgh areas. And so this community decides to fight back, but with rap. And this is how they do it. If you go ahead and play the trailer.
You seem to like a lot of movies where people fight back with music.
It's the best kind of fighting.
Party people in the place. Listen to me. I'm gonna tell you a story about an MC or a rapper. That's a person who rhymes to the beat. A musical rhythm on city street.
Eric LaSalle.
My name is Ice and I own this town.
Oh, yeah.
I'm only with Hood's not around.
Now John Hood's his name. Rapping's his game. Word manipulation's how he gained his fame and life. Robin Hood. He's honest and true and always down with his partner, the Wild Thing crew.
What's on your mind, man?
I want to fix your rapping hood. Now, rapping John Hood had one problem at hand. A mean power broker was taking the land. But John and his crew had their own tricks in store. So they robbed the rich and gave to the poor.
Messing with the wrong man.
And rapping John Hood realized that fact. And he and his crew are fighting back in
rapping.
You must see rapping.
Rapping.
This movie had to happen.
And yes, that was Ice-T. He was in this movie and the two Breaking movies. But this movie stars Mario Van Peebles. Eric LaSalle's in it.
Eric LaSalle.
Kadeem Hardison. Which, funny story, I showed this movie to a friend of mine who's an actress in L.A. She knows Kadeem Hardison. So she sent him a text message. She's like, she said, hey, I'm watching your movie Rappin'. And he texts back, no, don't turn it off. Don't watch it. Don't be ashamed, Kadeem.
Oh my God. Everything about that, the trailer was actually, I think like the Troll 2 trailer is not very funny, but that trailer is hilarious.
Yes. And I have a clip from the end, which is super hilarious. This movie is like half movie, half variety show.
Okay.
Because like it'll just cut to like two people singing or rapping and then they're never brought up again. It's just like, what?
Is it because they were actors that people might recognize?
No, they weren't trans actors. It was just, I don't know if some record label wanted to promote music, so they tried to use this movie as a vehicle to promote that, but they had like nothing to do with the overall plot.
Okay, let me see.
Oh, wait, this is the other one. Oh, you can play this one. There's two clips, I guess, I think I put in there.
Okay.
Just a little bit. I'll play
first, and I'm going to create a poll while we're watching this. I'll see if I can figure it out.
Play a little bit of this one.
Okay.
Yellow is a mellow. It's lots of fun. It's the color I wear when I don't get sun. Green is the color of cash, the color of a roster stash, the color of grass, the color of trees, the color of boogers when you sneeze.
What? No.
Gold is the color of 24 carats. Spark is like a diamond that makes me compare it to the way you make me feel. And so you should know.
It's brighter than the other side of a rainbow. Take it.
All right. Pink. I had to cut it off there, but... That was a segment where a Sesame Street like segment when they rapped about colors. Very formative.
With the kids. I don't think I have the other clip.
Did I not send that to you?
I don't think so.
Hold on.
Those two from rapping.
Oh wait. Maybe I can send it to you if I did.
Or drop it in the private chat.
Yeah.
Shoot. Yeah, somebody got it. Keith said it's Sesame Street. They also were trying to sort of ape different things that were popular at the time, like one of the singers in the trailer is wearing like the Michael Jackson glove. He's like clearly trying to style himself as Michael Jackson.
Let's see, right, man. Where is that clip? Okay, here it is. Hold on, let me put it in the chat here. Put it in the private chat. There we are.
Okay, let's see.
So, yeah, this clip is from the end of the movie. It's probably one of the most funny parts of the movie. This was Mario Van Peebles' first movie. It wasn't his last one, surprisingly.
Yeah, Robert just pointed out nobody knew who these people were in this movie, like Eric LaSalle and everything.
This is rap. What? It's what we feel and the way we say it when it's real. You once, now I'm telling you twice. Push for a third, because I'm not that nice. Hood try to be like calm as can be. Any more interruptions, you deal with me. Can't lobby in Congress for what we need. We don't have lawyers to fight his greed. You roughed us up and pushed us down.
Red, yellow, white, the black, and the brown.
Listen up, sucker, stop telling those lies. You can't even look at me straight in the eyes. You're all stuck up in your paper world. Don't care nothing about the boys and the girls.
You cut our heat and you raised our rent.
If he had his way, we'd live in a tent.
And you're sitting up there trying to look all nice. You're buying up the land for half the price.
A plus $2 is talking that trash.
Anything to make more cash.
Don't you
don't you know your only hit still pigeon? Money's become your new religion. Take off your glasses so you can see. The material God will never set you free.
The day you face yourself in the mirror is the day you see yourself in our mirror.
The good's in you, and it's not that far.
Have faith in the real man you are.
Dwayne,
wait a second. Two ways got to say it, hey?
The main thing you fail to understand is strength in the mind marks the true man. You're all caught up in your macho form, like a puppet on a string, dancing to the norm. If you look inside, I know you.
The thing is, I just have to pause this. This is like kind of like an after-school special where they're imparting this message. It's like what you're saying, where there's unnecessary scenes, or whatever. A lot of exposition where they have to tell you the moral of the story, and they're doing it in this cheesy rap style, like a very cheesy rap style. It makes me think of something that was made to be shown in a classroom.
This is modern day Shakespeare, Keri.
See, the better man that you could be if we all pull together and just stay true. I know we can do it.
We can start anew.
Rebuild God's dreams to make it right. It won't be easy, but it's worth the fight.
The bottom line of the situation is the land belongs to this congregation.
We can't stop, won't stop climbing that mountain. We can't stop, won't stop climbing that mountain. We can't stop, won't stop climbing that mountain.
Yeah, suck it. Yeah.
I like the old out of touch white guys. Yes. Kevin says make this stop. Ow. Okay, that's pretty pretty terribly good. We are doing a poll. I've just learned that you can only do 4 voting options in a poll on YouTube, so that's unfortunate. We only put 4 choices up there. We'll do another one later. Pick your favorite of those 4 bad movies if you want to weigh in. Somebody says this is like what Alex Stein does. Rapping.
I can see that.
Yeah. Oh my gosh, that's so funny. Okay. Should I move on to a bad one on my list?
Do it.
This one is also on your list, I believe. Hard Ticket to Hawaii?
Yes.
So this one was written and produced by this guy, Andy Sedaris. And he did just a whole score of these B movies in the 80s and 90s, and he had he would reuse a lot of the same actors. He would use a lot of Playboy playmates and penthouse models. He would use them as actors, and he would always like put himself in the movies, and it would just be these sort of over the top action films with hard to follow plots and really busty ladies and bad dialogue, bad acting, all of it. It's all the things that make the movie, and music. And so let's see, we'll play the trailer for Hard Ticket to Hawaii if you guys haven't seen this. This is probably my second favorite bad movie of all time. Worth watch. I've seen this more than once.
A lot of explosions and hot chicks in it.
Yeah.
He did like 12 movies.
I thought I added it to the screen, but I didn't. Oh. Here we go.
Hard Ticket to Hawaii. It has it all. The awesome, pristine beauty of the land. The warm caress of perfect beaches. The tantalizing wetness of the blue Pacific. Hawaii. It's a great place to visit. But you wouldn't want to die there.
Oh,
America's finest, ready and willing to pay the price for paradise. They're undercover, but not under-equipped. On this mission, there's hard flying, hard playing, hard fighting.
Agents are everywhere.
Have no mercy. Kill them all. This ain't no hula. It's a hard ticket to Hawaii.
It's excellent. I used to have the box set of several of his films. I couldn't find it. I did find the original DVD-R that someone burned me when I first saw this movie. And my friends and I, we had this joke band. This was some of my science and math high school friends. We had this joke band called Risky Biskness. We sang songs about lobster bisque. So stupid. It was just silly. We just made music. One of the guys, my friend's husband, he does make real music. And so he would help us. And we did a song. We did a Hard Ticket to Hawaii song. And I was looking for it. I couldn't find a digital version. I couldn't find the CD. If my friend ends up sending me the digital version, maybe we'll release it as some kind of special bonus. We'll send it as some kind of stupid MP3 track. To all the deprogrammed subscribers. But I did find here, let's put this up.
And by the way, I think all of Andy Sedaris's movies are on YouTube.
Are they? So you even have to get the box set. Just go on YouTube and watch them. These are really fun to watch with friends. And you know, I'm sober now, but back when they were fun if you're gonna have drinks or you know. What have you? Be
like, play like a drinking game.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a hard ticket to Hawaii. It's a hard ticket to Hawaii.
I would not expect the song to sound like that. If you just like, if I knew nothing about the movie, just need a title, that would be the least expected song.
Really?
Yeah.
It just sounds like
Hard Ticket to Hawaii. You think it'd be like Hard Ticket, like something like really heavy. And it's like Hard Ticket. And I love the song, but.
But this was in the 80s and the 90s. And so this is when, I think it's fitting for the types of songs they played in movies at the time. I don't know. Okay, let's see.
And this movie also has there's kind of a subplot that has nothing to do with the main plot about the snake. It's a giant snake, poison snake. And it has a very gratifying ending. The film, one of the most gratifying, like hilarious endings I've ever seen in a movie.
I've got a snake clip pulled up, actually. That's funny. Here we go. Oh no! It says danger. What are you doing?
Nasty
snake. This snake has like human eyes.
It's like fake looking, but it still like scares me.
I mean, mean, it's obvious. It's a very obvious Muppet.
Right.
Hmm. Wonder what happened here.
Bruce, Derek, did you guys load a crate with a snake in it marked contaminated on the Molokai cargo plane?
No, we didn't, boss. We loaded a box that just said live snake.
Live snake?
Yeah.
What's wrong with you guys? Is something baked your brains? Now I got to get on the radio and get that plane back here. That snake they have is dangerous. It's contaminated. Honolulu calling November 909-786. Do you read me? Come in, please.
Let's skip ahead where we see the snake again.
Really? Well, here's the care and feeding manual. Huh. All snakes eat meat. They swallow animals whole, often larger than themselves. Many snakes simply grab their victims and swallow them alive. Ugh. Others kill their prey first. Some snakes eat only once every few weeks. Well, I sure hope this one is not hungry, really.
Come on. Come on. I can't believe I'm this out. Let's go. Yeah,
I know. It's still out of order. Keep trying. It's a...
He's like laughing. Snake's laughing. Overkill.
It's very precise.
Where the hell did that snake come from?
such amazing dialogue. Where the hell did that snake come from? Kevin says, this is great. It is. Yeah. Amy says, oh, I'm definitely watching this. Yeah, if you just want to watch a silly popcorn movie that's going to make you laugh, that's so terrible that it's funny, and look, men and women alike will enjoy it. Like I said, it's a lot of just over the top, pointless action and explosions and guns and like busty ladies. So that's what these movies are. It's just, do you think he was trying to be, do you think, I heard you say something at the beginning that made me think, did you think Andy Sedaris, who made all these films, he was trying to be like make bad movies?
Yes.
Really?
But he could pull it off. Yes, I do.
He was a, if he had,
I think
if,
a lot of stuff in there was so over the top that it was obvious that it was trying tongue in cheek.
Hmm.
But he pulled it off. Like I said, most times you can't, in my opinion, pull off campy stuff.
But he did. Yes. He did a great job. I think we have a couple of super chats. I'll show some of these. The Twee Girl, thank you for the Canadian dollars. Twee Girl, she says, Phantom of the Paradise. Oh, that's just an excellent movie. That's a great movie. I haven't seen that in forever. I need to put that on my list to watch again. I don't think that's a bad movie, though, is it? I just think it's good. I have to go back and rewatch it and see what I think. But thank you for reminding me that. Yeah. Oh, Mystery Chris, you would love this movie, Phantom of the Paradise.
Huh.
Binary Bard for $5. Thank you so much. Says Credence Lenore. Gielgud was the character she played. I still need to watch it. LOL. Oh, so your friend's mom played the Goblin Queen in Troll 2. That popcorn scene that we saw, the corn scene, that was your friend's mom.
Yeah, she's that.
How funny. She had a main, that was a main character. Let's see. We've got a couple of other recommendations for films. Pirate Tomsky is another super chat. £10. Thank you, Pirate Tomsky. Says a film that loads of people call bad is Tremors, but that's effing amazing. yeah, Tremors is very entertaining. And people say it's bad. Do they? I don't know.
Well, some people maybe.
I think it's just a good movie. It's hard to tell what category I'd put that in, but definitely enjoy it. And then, a couple of people are recommending one. Well, there's one here that's on my list, so I'm going to hold off on putting that chat on the screen. Okay. That's Hard Ticket to Hawaii. I don't have much else to say about it other than it's terribly good.
Yeah. Good movie. Watch it.
Okay. What about you?
Can you pull up Never Too Young to Die, mm-hmm. which is a James Bond ripoff starring John Stamos in his first acting television or movie debut. And he plays a son of a spy played by George Lazenby, who was James Bond and on Her Majesty's Secret Service. And he's also a gymnast and ends up having to stop a villain played by Gene Simmons, who's trying to poison the city's water supply and who's also a transvestite. Yes, he plays a transvestite called Velvet Von Ragnar. And it's, yes. Just
I've never heard of this.
Really?
Okay. Okay. Yeah. A trash can cinema film. Is that really the production company?
No, I think this is just a YouTube video.
Oh, it's a YouTube channel or something? Okay.
What happened?
We had visitors.
Visitors? What were they after?
A disc.
Elusive disc. Damn. Any idea who could be behind this?
Ragnar.
Ragnar? I thought he disappeared years ago.
Yeah, well, he's reappeared. And guess what? He's performing a nightclub act.
Yeah! I'm gonna poison your water supply! I'll go for ransom, for jewels, for money!
Poison! Someone has stolen our dish.
They would be so canceled today because you could not make a trans person the bad guy.
Yes.
This is so comical. Are you sure it's not a parody?
No. Well, they're embarrassed by it. John Stamos is embarrassed by this movie. Even though now he's kind of warming up because there's more of a positive view towards it now. But like he thought he was going to become a big movie star because it was like his first movie. And they just thought there was going to be like a series. It's going to be like a new James Bond. It's horrible.
I love the way this bad guy, this trans bad guy is like, just tells you what he's going to do. I'm going to poison the water supply. Yes.
Get me Stargrove! I want Stargrove!
Lance Stargrove.
All of your favorites have like great music.
Yeah.
Great cheesy music.
Stargirl.
So what'll it be?
How about a lube job?
What do you want?
Fork over some ramp key, bitch. We're with tenderizer.
Who are these bad guys? Who looks like that?
The name Stargirl.
Even in the 80s, right? Like, who looks like that? What bad guys look like that?
By the way, that's Vanity, one of Prince's girls.
Great Asians weren't really ever supposed to care for anyone.
It's gone way beyond that for me.
It's a really awkward sex scene in this movie, too.
Oh. And they follow it up with... And there's more shooting.
What kind of design and drug do you want?
So you see... You're never too young to die.
Never too young. You're never too young to die.
Freddy Krueger.
Yeah. Gene Simmons. Crazy.
Yeah.
That looks really terribly bad.
Yes.
I am going to watch that one. I don't know if I'm going to watch Rappin', but.
What?
Maybe. But first, I'm going to watch this one. Thank you.
Yeah, this one's on YouTube, I believe.
Okay. That's terrible. Okay. Well, I guess. Is it my turn?
Yeah.
But this is one I discovered. You mentioned Alamo Draft House and how they curate these really terrible movies. And this is one that I saw. It's a horror movie. So if you don't like horror movies, I'm just going to give you a little warning. You may not want to watch this one. It's about a murderous turkey. It's called Blood Freak. And so they usually show it at Thanksgiving.
Yeah, I've seen this. Yeah.
Have you seen this?
Yeah.
Okay. Where did you see it? Did you see it at the Alamo Draft House?
No, I saw it at a group. I used to meet up with a group that watched really bad movies.
Okay. Here we go. I can't remember if...
See Blood Freak, horrifying, addicted monster whose thirst for an addict's blood will lead you to a horror beyond belief. Blood Freak, to survive, addicts must die.
By the way, what he's talking about at the beginning, this guy, the lead character, Herschel, he's addicted to marijuana. Which anybody, it's a little over the top. It kind of is like
after school special.
Yeah, but what's that? What's that really famous one that we covered once in propaganda films?
Reefer Madness.
Reefer Madness. Yes. So basically, he smokes a joint and then he becomes addicted and then he starts threatening people. Like, you got me hooked. You got to give me more. I'm addicted to the marijuana. Just a little like, wait, what? And so he agrees. He's part of this experiment. These turkey farmers, they get him to eat this turkey meat they did some kind of experiment on. And they bribe him. They get it by offering him marijuana to feed his addiction. And so then he turns into this turkey slash human thing. He's got a big old turkey head, see?
Well, he seems to just act normal.
Also, the reason that this is so gross. We don't have to watch the whole thing. It's terrible. I'll just say the reason that he's murderous now that he's part turkey, part man, is not because he wants to take revenge at humans or the state of being or anything. The reason he's murderous is because he's still addicted to marijuana, but he can't smoke it now and with his big old turkey head. So he has to target pot smokers and kill them and drink their pot blood. In the end, it's a big old anti-marijuana movie with a turkey murderer. So anyway, that's it. It's terrible. We don't have to watch it because somebody says, oh yeah, yeah, I know some people don't like horror and they're like, oh yeah, Lily Fox Valley says it's actually kind of creepy. For real, it is. It is kind of creepy and also very terrible, and the special effects are terrible. So there we go. That's Blood Freak.
How often do you watch that one?
You know, I did go to the Thanksgiving screening once or twice. I can't remember that's about it. I think I've seen it maybe three times.
Yeah. So not an annual tradition.
No, no, not a tradition. I haven't seen it in years at this point. I should, I don't even know if I want to rewatch it, but it's still on my list just because if you haven't seen it, it's like, I can't believe somebody actually conceived of this, put money into it, like made it, that they got people to agree to be in it. Like every step of the way, you're like, wasn't somebody like, nah. So there's that one. Okay, what's next on your list?
If you could pull up the trailer for Samurai Cop. Have you seen the Samurai Cop? This is one of the more famous ones. So bad it's good. So this is a cop who's not a samurai, but is fighting people who know martial arts and are trafficking drugs or something. I don't know. Just play the trailer.
Don't move.
What are you going to do? Shoot me?
His real name is Joe Marshall.
It's Robert Sedar.
They call him Samurai. He speaks fluent Japanese.
Omaha, Yamaha, whatever his face's name is, right?
Are you Fujiyama?
He got his martial arts training from the masters in Japan.
No.
He was brought over here from the police force in San Diego to fight us.
I want his head cut off and brought here.
I will bring you his head and I will place it on your piano. And we'll see who the real samurai.
What? No. No.
Damn.
Okay. Do they know they're making a parody, or are they?
No, no. But this is what, like,
genuinely bad. Okay.
This the director is an Iranian guy who was inspired by Lethal Weapon and wanted to make that and. Like these guys in the movie, they didn't know it was going to be this bad.
It's just genuinely horrible. Okay.
Tell me who hired you to kill a cop.
Hey, look.
Police, don't move. You're under arrest.
Hey, counselor. We'll see you in court.
Well, this one's dead too. Not captured alive.
Have you been circumcised? Well, your doctor must have cut a big portion of it off.
No, he was a good doctor. I'm telling these son of a bitches that if they continue killing our children, I'll have their stinking bodies in garbage bags and ship them back to Japan for fertilizer. Got it?
I feel like somebody stuck a big club up my ass, and it hurts. I've got to figure out a way to get it out of there.
That's the last quote of the trailer? What? Interesting choice.
So it's hilarious because the main guy, I forget the actor's name, Matt something, he was in this movie. They filmed it like pretty quickly. And some months go by, he thought all filming was done. So he cut off his hair. And then the director calls him back to do some more shoots. And he's like, oh, I cut off my hair. And the director drove him to a wig store. They got a wig. And so in half the movie, he's wearing an obvious wig.
No.
Yeah. So bad. No. But this is one of the example of one of the movies where you can tell that they filmed reaction shots and just edited in later. Hence, like, you saw a lot of those shots of the black guy of just him, like, laughing or just making a surprise face. Yes. Yeah. That had, like, nothing to do with, like, what they were filming when they filmed that scene. It was just later added to that. And so it just
called him out for a day and they're like, okay, now laugh. Oh.
And so, yeah, this movie is kind of a cult classic amongst the fans of bad movies. And so popular that they decided to make a sequel. And sequel, I haven't seen a sequel, but the sequel is too self-aware. And so that has Tommy Wiseau. You know, we'll play a little bit. It's not funny, but I just want to give you...
It's not funny because they're self-aware. Okay, yes. That it's bad. Got it.
We knew this day would come. He has returned.
Joe Marshall?
He is our Antichrist. And he must be defeated.
Ah!
know, I play rest. I just wanted to give an example of what the people.
It's nothing like the first one.
No, no. And they have Tommy Wiseau, which we'll talk about in a moment. But
That's nothing like the first one.
Yeah.
Okay. Good. I've got my friend just sent me a link to the Hard Ticket to Hawaii song that I mentioned before. So we might play it at the end if I can get it pulled up. Just as a little extra bonus. We'll see what you think of it.
All right.
Okay, well, so next on my list, let me pull up a chat because somebody mentioned it in chat. It's not always independent films made by foreigners that are terrible. Showgirls. Is Showgirls not on your list?
It's a great movie. What are you talking about?
It is a terrible movie, but it's so good. And
Jesse Spano shows her boobs in there.
It's just... yeah,
it's weird. Like if you go from watching Saved by the Bell and immediately watch that film after, you can't help but just think that is Jesse Spano, and you're so confused. You're like, what? Why is she getting naked? I thought she was like ultra feminist.
Yes, there's so many things wrong with it. There's so many weird things. I mean, I wasn't huge into Saved by the Bell. I hear what you're saying. But I had that reaction to Kyle MacLachlan because I was a huge fan of Twin Peaks and I knew him as Agent Cooper. And then to see him in such a weird role and that weird hot tub scene is just like, what are you doing? Why? I'm like, why? How could you choose to be in this? At first I felt like, you know, he should be embarrassed of it. Now I'm more of the opinion of you just embrace it. You just be humble. And you're like, yeah, I was in this terrible movie.
And I'm just shocked that that movie is directed by Paul Verhoeven. He's the one who did RoboCop and Total Recall, Starship Troopers.
Really?
I think he did Basic Instinct. Yeah.
What? Yeah, we're going to watch the trailer. Yeah, Devin is right. Everything in this movie is weird. Everything. Okay, we're going to watch the trailer. Hopefully it's not too over the top.
What are you going to Vegas for? You gonna win?
I'm gonna dance.
There's a spot open in the chorus line. We're auditioning tomorrow morning. I think you should try out.
I got an audition!
Okay, ladies, I got one interest here, and that's the show. I don't care whether you live or die. I want to see you dance, and I want to see you smile. I can't use you if you can't smile. I can't use you if you can't show. I can't use you if you can't sell.
From the creators of Basic Instinct, the last time they took you to the edge, this time they're taking you all the way.
We take the cash, we cash the check, we show them what they want to see.
You got more natural talent when you dance than anybody I've ever seen.
She's going down to the Stardust.
Why do you think this one is so bad? Can I ask you? Because you've got some, I think, pretty good, adequate actors in it. I mean, is it her? Is she just a really bad actress? Is it the script?
All like, of what?
You know, I know what they were trying to do, and it's so funny. They're like, you know, from the people who brought you Basic Instinct. They're like, oh, we're making this sexy movie about dancing. It's going to be great. And I think what was the movie that had just come out? There was another movie with Demi Moore around the same time. Striptease. And there was like a lot of these kind of, you know, Hollywood does that thing. They're like, oh, this is successful. Let's do something like that, right? They were trying to do another one of these like sexy movies with a dancer, and it just completely failed. It's not even sexy because it's so bad. So you think it's bad script, bad acting, all of it?
Yes. I think all of that. I think the sex scenes was even weirder. Like you're saying, the whole thing is weird, like a very awkward, like I can't even compare it to any like sex scene in a movie because it was just so strange, like everything about it.
But he said we might get a copyright strike for showing that one, so I'm going to quit showing that trailer. I wonder if we can show a scene
of Showgirls.
Yeah.
Hmm.
Here, I've got one scene. This is a scene that a lot of people like, myself included.
Hey, I didn't even know about the audition until afterwards. Do you like my nails?
Hey, you're blocked on YouTube right now.
Are we?
Yeah. You're getting copyright struck immediately.
Oh. Oh, that sucks. Let me stop playing this.
Yeah.
Are we? So nobody can even see what we're talking about doing? Are we back? It's probably because we played Showgirls so much of the trailer. But I thought it was fair use. We're back.
You're back. Yeah. Because you stopped playing Showgirls. Yeah.
Oh.
I don't want anybody to see that terrible.
Yeah. All right.
Okay.
I'm going to duck out. I just want to say.
Thanks, Pirate.
Thank you. That was Pirate Topsy, our producer, guys. We had a boomer moment. I was like, what's happening? Why is he popping in? What's going on? We're just watching a clip from Showgirls. We were watching the bad nail scene. Aw, thank you, Pirate. Okay, so I guess we're not going to show any more of Showgirls. It's terrible. You should probably watch it. Although, if you don't like gratuitous nudity and sex scenes, maybe it's not your type of bad movie, because they do throw in, like, they're really trying to make a sexy movie. I just think it fails because it's not good. So the badness trumps the sexiness. Okay, what's next on your list? Hopefully it's so bad and not mainstream like that one that we won't get struck by showing it.
Let's see. I could do either one or two more. See, we can do, let's pull up the Neil Breen one, please.
Okay.
Are you familiar with Neil Breen?
No, I don't know any of the rest of the ones on your list.
So Neil Breen, how does one explain Neil Breen? He's an architect in real life, apparently. He decided to do some movies starting in 2005, where he produced, directed, wrote, starred in, catered his own movies, and they've become cult classics. And I'm convinced that he's in on a joke by now, even maybe ever since the beginning, because he's made soon to be six of these movies, and they're all the same quality. And then to me, that just suggests that someone's in on a joke. But it's still funny, because kind of like Arctic Hawaii or some of the other ones where he has the hallmarks of, like, generally bad films, even though I think he's conscious of what he's doing, like the bad acting, the, you know, pointless scenes, you know, the stilted, you know, characters talking to nobody, but you can tell the editing's horrible. But this is his, I think it was the movie came out with last. He has a new one coming out this year.
I mean, this is 2018.
Yeah. Just show a little bit of this. Don't show the whole thing. Well, it's a long thing. It's, you know, almost 4 minutes.
I'm going to start right here.
There was a bright light in the sky and time stood still. We were both selected. The pure majesty of nature.
What?
Yes.
Programmable virtual reality. The corrupt version.
A limitless digital universe connecting all shared virtual reality.
This is terrible.
Yes.
Digital tribes. I miss what I never knew.
I'll take you out to dinner.
Let's have a drink.
She's not acting. This is real.
Get out of my face.
Hey, let's have a drink.
Leave me alone. I have a drink.
I'll meet you back here
at 8 o'clock.
I miss my brother. I'm with you.
Look at his hand. It's just disappearing behind his.
Thank you. programmable matter. Kuz's biological mutant warfare plans.
He's like just rattling off things like digital yes. reality, programmable matter. Like he's just like
all of his movies must are like that.
Stop.
What?
Like he all of his movies where he tries to have like a deep theme where he's making comments about, you know, the environment or politics, and it's just a jumbled mess.
How'd you discover this guy?
Watching movies with friends. So.
Just how terrible it is.
Yeah.
Who am I? What am I?
It's a killer with unidentifiable DNA.
I love the low resolution.
In AI, fright and interest.
You should have started but, with this at the very beginning.
Yeah.
Really bad. What were you about to say?
Oh, no.
Oh no, I went back in time.
In AI, fright and interest are not far from each other. Things can become real in your mind. I trust you completely, and you believe things you wouldn't ordinarily believe.
Who's there?
Justice is served.
Wait, what?
This is what? Where we bring you all to rot and die.
What?
Keri, I will love you for all eternity.
We will live in a virtual metaverse, a virtual universe, living in our own world every day. Everyone has the right to love and peace. I'll be right.
He has to because he first started making movies in 2005. He's still making movies and they're all the same.
This is terrible. Oh, Neil Breen. Okay. So people in the chat, Blarpool says he's in on the joke for sure. I don't know.
No,
did Zuckerberg produce this film? No. I wonder if anybody has anybody in the chat seen this other than Mr. Chris? I feel like this is a relatively new, like you might create the trend of this. Are other people, is this a cult classic yet?
His films, yeah, he's got a pretty big following online.
Well, maybe it's just me. I've never heard of him. Okay, what else do you have?
Pull up The Room. Now, you said you haven't seen this.
Believe it or not, I have not seen The Room. I know it's always on the list, the best worst film. You sent me a link to the best moments clip. Is that what you wanted to pull up?
I'd pull up the trailer. Or maybe, I'm trying to think, maybe just play a trailer. So this is a film by a strange man called Tommy Wiseau. It's a love story, a tragic love story. And it's been voted the worst movie of all time by many people. It was so popular because one of the actors in it wrote a book. And I guess James Franco saw it and they made a movie called The Disaster Artist. Came out a few years ago. where James Franco played Tommy Wiseau, and it's about the making of this film.
Let's go ahead. You know why I never watched this one?
Why?
Because they were showing this at the midnight screenings and stuff too, back when I was getting into Troll 2 and other midnight movies and terrible movies. Somebody told me that this one's really boring and that it's actually just bad and not bad good. Are they wrong?
No, I think his acting is what makes it interesting, because he's just such a weird dude that it keeps your interest. But it does get a little repetitive because there's like four or five sex scenes in it for whatever reason. And most of it takes place in a room, hence the name. But yeah, he's just such a strange guy that you're just intrigued the entire length of the film.
Okay, let's see.
Hi, babe. I have something for you.
What is it?
Just a little something.
I used to know a girl. She had a dozen guys. One of them found out about it, beat her up so bad she ended up in a hospital on Guerrero Street.
What a story, Mark.
Yeah, you can say that again.
You shouldn't have any secrets from me.
Women change their minds all the time.
Oh, come on, Johnny's my best friend.
Why, Lisa? Please talk to me, please.
You think girls like to cheat like guys do? What makes you say that?
You're lying. I never hit you.
I don't know. I'm just thinking.
You are tearing me apart, Lisa.
You really don't know, do you?
Maybe I know more than you think I do, Mark.
Mark?
So Lisa changed her mind about you. Wake up, man. What planet are you on?
Satisfied you will come to me.
Get out of my house.
I kill you. I'll bring him in full of my money.
Stop it!
What?
Saying anything, man. Leave your stupid comments in your pocket.
Is this the real trailer?
I don't think there is a real trailer.
Okay.
Why? Why is this happening? Why? God, forgive me.
Okay.
You know what they say, love is blind.
Yeah, you're not amused.
I mean, I don't know if I'm gonna watch this one. Is it funny?
Yes, because he's just, like I said, so weird, and there's so many awkward parts, and it's one of the most quotable movies. I'm sure you heard people go, "Oh, hi, Mark."
Yeah, I guess so.
I guess so. Okay,
you really have me with, what's the one with John Stamos?
Never Too Young to Die.
You really have me with Never Too Young to Die. Definitely watching that one. I don't know about The Room. Here's a best moments that you sent me. Should we pull that up?
I get to play a little bit of it. Yeah.
Okay. Let's see. Do people in the chat, have they seen this one? I know this is like the one that, yeah, everybody says.
Oh, yeah.
Everybody says, oh, you have to watch. It's the worst. It's the best worst movie. But I think Troll 2 is the best worst movie.
You can fast forward a little bit. They include this long intro.
Hi.
Can I help you?
Yeah, can I have a dozen?
Yeah, right there.
And she was sitting, drinking her coffee, and she was so beautiful. And I say hi to her. That's how we met.
You didn't get it, did you?
That son of a bitch told me that I would get it within 3 months. I saved them bundles. They're crazy. I don't think I will ever get it. They betrayed me. They didn't keep their promise. They tricked me, and I don't care anymore. I did not hit her. It's not true. It's bullshit. I did not hit her. I did not. Oh, hi, Mark.
Oh, hi, Mark.
Just a chicken. Chip, 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 chip.
You can come out now, Johnny. She's gone.
In a few minutes, bitch.
It's very strange these days. I used to know a girl. She had a dozen guys. One of them found out about it, beat her up so bad she ended up in a hospital on Guerrero Street.
What a story, Mark.
You're lying. I never hit you. You are tearing me apart, Lisa.
You know what they say. Love is blind.
How was work today?
Oh, pretty good. We got a new client, and the bank will make a lot of money.
What client?
I cannot tell you. It's confidential.
Oh, come on. Why not?
No, I can't. Anyway, how is your sex life?
See? Just didn't respond to what's being said. He just, it's so bizarre.
Okay. That's ridiculous. Well, let's see if the... We've already had a boomer moment tonight. We already got a copyright strike because I played the trailer from Showgirls. But we're back and we tried a poll. Let's see what the poll says. We asked, what's the best worst movie? And the choices were Miami Connection, Troll 2, Rappin', or The Room. People picked Troll 2 over The Room. 40% for Troll 2. 34% for The Room, 20% for Miami Connection, and 6% for Rappin.
Oh.
That's what we have. Thank you guys for voting, even if you voted incorrectly.
Miami Connection. That's number one.
Pirate, Robert. Robert says Troll 2 is funnier. Oh, has he seen both? I don't know. I guess I'll give The Room a shot. I should after all this time. Pirate Tomsky, thank you, says smash the like button. If you like the show, if you like hanging out with us.
I have a couple of funny videos. Can we show that real quick before we...
Yeah, which ones?
So if you do the Tommy Wiseau skit one.
So are these spoofs of The Room?
One of them is a spoof. The other one's an edit. This one's from Patrick Williams' channel, I think. And this is Tommy Wiseau as the Batman.
In a dangerous city.
Hey man, give me your money.
A perfect man.
Ruth is such a wonderful person. He donated $1 million to charity and took in that poor orphan as his ward.
And so handsome too.
If everyone helped each other, the world would be a better place.
Give me your money. Give me your money right now!
Hey, you!
Is the perfect crime fighter.
Stop that! I'll kill you! Oh, hi. I'm the Batman.
Batman is pretty hot.
Oh my god, are you into him?
You look so sexy, Selina.
Master Wayne, be careful. This could be dangerous.
Don't worry about it, Alfred. Everything will be fine. I will find who killed my parents! I will get them!
What's the matter, bat brain? Chicken?
I will tear you apart, Riddler. I will tear crime apart. Hugo, you always play psychologist. My parents are dead. Why?
I'm vengeance. I am the knight. I am Batman.
I am Batman. A film by Tommy Wiseau.
Okay, that's pretty funny. Somebody said we neglected to play Is There a Tattoo of That?
I put that link in there.
You did?
I did.
I have a... Oh, yeah, you did. I have a tattoo here for you. Yeah. Oh, my goodness. Mystery Chris. You guys, can you see this? People get these actual tattoos done of this guy, Tommy Wiseau. That's how you say his name?
Yeah.
From The Room. Look at these. And then there's one here of what's
Milhouse.
That? Milhouse from The Simpsons asked Tommy Wiseau saying, "You're tearing me apart, Lisa." And people have stuff on the tattooed. This woman has on her arm, it's tattooed, "Oh, hi, Mark." So weird.
Yeah.
So weird. That's the one I found right there. This Reddit one on Reddit. Wow, there's lots of them. Here's one, a cartoon one. "Oh, hi, Mark."
That doesn't even look like him.
No. Bizarre.
Yeah, people love this movie. It's the new Rocky Horror Picture Show. Because I don't know, do people even like do the meetups for Rocky Horror Picture Show? Remember they used to like meet at midnight and people dress up, throw rice and stuff. I don't know if they still do that. But for The Room, they do stuff like that where people bring spoons and footballs.
Oh, yeah. I don't know if they still do that for Rocky Horror, but they do meetups and things like that where they cook with, like, they make the green goo and stuff for Troll 2. Okay, so I just looked up Troll 2 tattoo. And there are a few. Now there's a lot of just the troll dolls mixed in here, which I don't know why you would do that either. Why would you get a troll doll tattoo? It's so weird. But this first one here, that's from the movie Troll 2. That's one of the goblins. I don't know. That's the only one I see. The rest of these look like with troll doll stuff. But somebody has one.
Who would you respect more? Someone with a tattoo of a troll from Troll 2 or of the toy troll?
Troll 2. Obviously. Duh. Why would you get a troll doll tattooed on you?
I don't know.
Oh, hello. Sci-Fi for Me TV is here. Hello. We're going to hang out soon. He says, they still do that. Yes, they still do the Rocky Horror Picture Show stuff. I didn't know that. There's a festival for the Big Lebowski. Really? Any of these things that become cult classics, I guess you're going to have these sort of meetups and these fun inside jokes and everybody knows the same lines. And
yeah, I mean, the internet just did wonders for finding like all these old movies and shows and fandoms developing around it. It's just really amazing what's happened in the last 20 years.
Lily of the Fox Valley says knitters need to get on knitting control two doll for Keri. I would not pass it up. Troll two. If you do one, do the googly eyed one. There's one that has like really googly eyes. Okay. I think we should wrap it up. Do you think we should wrap? We've been going about 2 hours.
Yeah, I think it was good.
Yeah. Somebody says, Twee Girl says, I just checked. There is an Elizabeth Berkley Showgirls tattoo. What? No. Let's see if we get showing this.
Is it clothed?
Oh my gosh, there's several of them.
Whoa.
Who is this?
Elizabeth Berkley herself.
Look, there's some this realistic looking one here, this first one of her face from the film. Then there's Versace or whatever. Cartoonish looking. I don't get it. I don't get why people do these.
That's weird. Okay, well, whatever.
Pirate Tomsky's back. Pirate, did we get struck again?
No. Scott, okay. Take me out.
Okay. I guess he's doing something in the background. Okay. SC DeGrand says, great episode, guys. Good night and have a pleasant tomorrow. You have a pleasant tomorrow as well. You guys, thanks for hanging out with us tonight. This has been a live episode of Pop Culture. Tonight, we just had fun talking about some of the best, worst movies out there. And we'll put a full list of them in the description below of the ones that we recommend, our favorite bad movies. And again, not bad movies. Bad movies are not worth watching. These are horrible, horrible movies that are so horrible. There's this transformation that happens and they become good movies. And I don't quite know what that winning formula is yet, but I think it involves sincerity and being bad in every possible way, not just in one realm. So I think that's it.
They're kind of endearing too. Yeah.
They're endearing. There's something endearing about them. Yes. But thank you guys for hanging out. Tomorrow, we have a deprogrammed interview coming out at 6 o'clock Central Time. And that's with Dr. Joel Brown. am very excited about it. He was just wonderful to speak with. I've really enjoyed doing these interviews again lately. And if you know him from Twitter, he's had a lot of tweets go viral recently, and he talks about leaving the left and, you know, being pulled into sort of the BLM, maybe part of social justice, and then what it was like waking up and leaving that. And I hope you guys will tune in for that. But thanks for hanging out tonight, and we'll see you later.
Bye.
Bye.
Thank you to today's sponsor, the Church on the Square of Georgetown, Texas, which happens to be my church. My church is no longer allowed to advertise on Facebook, which is unfortunate because that's how I and a lot of other church members originally found them. They've been told that they violate community standards. There's no details there of what that means, but you guys know the score. Anyway, since they're not allowed to advertise, I'm here to give them a plug. You can find them online at thechurchonthesquare.org. You can also find videos of all the sermons and some other kinds of content on their YouTube page at Church on the Square. You can also join us. If you happen to be in the Georgetown, Texas area, we meet every Sunday at Ken's Guitars. That's K-E-N-Z, Ken's Guitars, right on the Georgetown Square. We meet outside right on the square. Sometimes if the weather's nice, you might find us there. You might find us outside in front of Ken's. But if you're local, I hope to see you.